Avant tout, je parle maintenant en français, si ça ne vous gêne pas. Avant tout, je vais demander à Jean-Pierre Léaud d'ouvrir officiellement ce symposium et de dire quelques mots. Il est vraiment, je te remercie d'être là pour ouvrir ce mot, parce que ce n'était pas du tout prévu. Donc, c'est un cadeau que tu nous fais. Et merci pour ce cadeau. Et quelques mots, Jean-Pierre, sur Jean-Luc Godard.
Merci, Paolo. Je suis très touché de devoir commenter l'œuvre de Jean-Luc. Je suis sans doute le seul à pouvoir parler de mon intimité avec Jean-Luc. Mais je ne le ferai pas. Je laisse la parole au sémiologue et théoricien et à Jim Jarmusch. Cependant, je tiens à remercier Paolo Branco d'avoir programmé toute l'œuvre de Jean-Luc dans le festival qu'il a créé. Merci, je rejoins le public.
Merci. Merci beaucoup. Jonathan, before you start, I'd like Jim to say some words, and after we let you with Pascal, Luis, and everyone that wants to join us in the conversation. Jim.
Well, thank you. I have nothing prepared. I didn't know I was going to say anything. But I must say that anyone who is interested in cinema since 1959 is inspired by or interested in or somehow affected by the films of Jean-Luc Godard. And they are innovations, they are very daring, they are experiments, they are, I don't know, very playful, they are political, they are about the differences between men and women, they're about crime fiction, they're about cars, they're about girls, and they're about politics, and many other things. So I have a wealth of his films inside me from many, many years ago. From the first film I saw in New York, I believe, was Breathless, and since have followed him as a kind of master artist. I got to meet him once in 1985, only once, in Salsa Maggiore, Italy. And I was a young filmmaker. I had so many questions to ask him. And we were standing outside on a street corner. And I wanted to ask him so many things. And he turned and said, "Let me ask you something. Do you like the ice cream in Italy or the ice cream in France? Have you, the gelati is very good here, but do you know on Ile de la Cité in Paris, the ice cream there?" And I said, "Yes, I do." "And which do you prefer?" And I said, "Well, I don't know. I think I prefer the French ice cream." And he said, "Ah, me too." And then he said, "You know, I don't really like to leave France so much. I like Italy very much, but I like to be home where I prefer the ice cream." And then he turned and said, "It's very nice to meet you. I have to go now." And this was my encounter with Jean-Luc Godard. I was waiting for many years, and we spoke about only ice cream. But he was also smoking one of those corn paper gitans, the yellow ones, and he had on dark glasses. And then I went and told all my friends, I met Jean-Luc Godard. I got to talk with him, you know, but only about ice cream. But in deference to a great writer about films, Jonathan Rosenbaum, whose work I respect very deeply, I must say I like very much a quote of Jean-Luc Godard. This is not an exact quote, but he once said, "Filmmakers and film critics are in the same army, but the critics are firing on their own troops." And I feel this almost always, although never from, I always learn something, because Jonathan's work is like that of an artist, and his perceptions are invaluable. But I like this quote very much, and I also remember someone asked him, what is the difference between watching a film in the cinema and watching a film on television? And he said, well, in the cinema you look up at the film, and on TV you look down. So yes, he said many beautiful things, but I have nothing prepared any further, but I find him to be one of the most inspiring artists in cinema ever. So what a strange and beautiful gift to us all, the amazing work of Jean-Luc Godard, and a very varied body of work that it is also.
Thank you. Now I'll ask Pascal that he, if someone can talk about Godard, Pascal, because il est quand même, bon, je parle en français parce que c'est plus simple pour moi, parce que c'est quelqu'un qui a accompagné, je pense, de près tout son œuvre. Et surtout, aujourd'hui, on parle un peu de sa première période qui va de À bout de souffle à quoi, Antonio, je crois, jusqu'à Weekend, c'est ça? Non. Donc cette première période, jusqu'à Made in USA, au fond, c'est cette première période. Donc après, je laisserai Jonathan faire toute son masterclass dans cette période, parce que c'est lui qui après que aussi pourra, d'un côté critique, de parler bien de cette période. Mais Pascal, il faut rappeler que Pascal, avant d'être le cinéaste qu'il est, et le scénariste formidable qu'il est aussi, il a été surtout un critique de cinéma très important. Quelqu'un qui a rejoint l'équipe de cinéma dans les années, fin des années 60, donc c'est une période très particulière pour la critique à cette
que
à
tu
ce
connais,
moment-là, hein,
que tu as bien connu,
et que j'ai bien connu, et mais en même temps, donc c'est quelqu'un qui a une réflexion sur le cinéma depuis toujours et depuis le début de donc même avant de devenir ce qu'il est devenu aujourd'hui, le cinéaste important qu'il est, donc c'est à toi, Pascal.
Merci, Paul. Je suis un peu comme Jim, j'ai vraiment rien préparé. Alors, je voudrais faire un peu comme lui, c'est-à-dire évoquer un souvenir concernant Jean-Luc, enfin, un ou deux, plusieurs. Et donc, je vais parler, en fait, d'une période qui est d'avant cette période où je suis devenu peut-être un critique de cinéma, donc où j'ai dû réfléchir sur les films. J'avais 15 ans, j'étais en vacances en Angleterre, j'avais rencontré une copine, une amie, j'ai vu qu'il y avait À bout de souffle qui passait dans un cinéma de Oxford Circus à Londres, et je crois qu'il devait être sorti déjà en France, mais je l'avais manqué, et j'ai décidé d'aller voir ce film avec elle. C'était un après-midi, à l'époque le cinéma était cinéma permanent, enfin ce qu'il est toujours, mais enfin on pouvait rester autant qu'on voulait, et j'ai vu ce film, je ne sais pas ce que j'ai vu, enfin je me souviens de l'impression extraordinaire, de ce sentiment à la fois de voir quelque chose que je n'avais jamais vu au cinéma et qui en même temps rencontrait tout ce que j'avais espéré voir. Et j'ai été tellement saisi que j'ai obligé ma pauvre copine à revoir le film une deuxième fois à la séance suivante. C'est-à-dire, je crois que c'est la seule fois de ma vie que je suis resté deux fois de suite à voir un film. Voilà, le revoir une deuxième fois tout de suite, immédiatement. Et j'ai eu l'impression de voir quelque chose, à la fois l'émergence d'un langage nouveau, est-ce que c'était vraiment, puisque ce film qui était un petit film policier dont je crois, Jean-Paul Belmondo qui le jouait pensait qu'il ne sortirait jamais, a créé une sorte de bouleversement dans toute l'écriture cinématographique. Quelque chose de nouveau se disait sur l'amour, sur la narration, sur le récit. Et ça m'a saisi d'une façon vraiment très forte. Et donc c'était en 1961, donc pendant les vacances à Londres, en Angleterre. Et ensuite, évidemment, j'ai voulu faire du cinéma. J'ai essayé de faire le concours de l'IDEC et puis je l'ai raté en 1966. Je précise ces dates parce que voilà. En 1968, j'étais étudiant à Nanterre. J'étais gauchiste, j'ai participé aux manifestations et j'ai participé au mouvement ce qu'on appelait le mouvement du 22 mars de Cohn-Bendit. Et Cohn-Bendit a été expulsé cette même année et donc il est allé vivre à Francfort. Et avec une amie, j'ai décidé d'aller le rendre visite à Francfort. Donc au mois de décembre 1968, je suis allé à Francfort le voir, et donc pour la première fois j'ai rencontré Jean-Luc Godard en chair et en os, parce qu'il était venu également lui rendre visite avec Anne Wiazemski, et donc j'ai vu cette personne qui ne m'a pas parlé, puisque j'avais rien à dire, je n'avais pas du tout encore. Il se trouve que je suis rentré au cahier du cinéma 2 mois plus tard et que donc j'ai commencé une carrière de critique après, mais donc à ce moment-là je n'avais pas d'autre rapport au film que de spectateur, mais j'étais encore marqué par ce que Abou Tsouf m'avait apporté, que je ne savais pas trop traduire par la suite quand je suis devenu critique. J'ai essayé de traduire en des termes peut-être un peu trop savants, quelquefois un peu cuistres, ce que j'avais éprouvé concernant ce que le cinéma de Godard apportait, c'est-à-dire une nouvelle façon de plus étrange, plus rapide, plus heurtée, et en tout cas totalement nouvelle et plus poétique aussi. De raconter des histoires au cinéma. Par la suite, je l'ai rencontré quelques fois, j'ai fait des interviews avec lui, j'ai toujours été un très très mauvais intervieweur comme critique de cinéma, je ne savais jamais quelles questions poser, je ne savais pas quoi faire des entretiens que je faisais, mais voilà. Et du coup, c'était moins intéressant pour moi de le rencontrer dans ces interviews, mais je garde un souvenir en tout cas ineffaçable de cette première fois qu'a représenté Abou Tsouf, et qui a été aussi une première fois, je pense, pour beaucoup de gens dans le cinéma à ce moment-là. Voilà tout ce que je peux dire.
Je voulais simplement faire une question, si on pose une question, c'est que pour toi, en revoyant toute cette première période, ça veut dire on parle un peu d'Abou Tsouf jusqu'à Weekend, à part évidemment Abou Tsouf qui a marqué, est-ce qu'il y a un film de lui particulièrement qui t'a marqué et qui tu as revu et que en les revoyant, tu es moins séduit ce qui était à l'époque quand tu voyais les films de Godard. Je voulais un peu savoir un peu.
Alors, il y a un film que j'ai revu très très souvent. Enfin, il y a quelques films que je chéris particulièrement de Godard. Il y a eu Masculin Féminin avec Jean-Pierre, Léo en particulier. Et la façon très différente dont Jean-Luc utilisait Jean-Pierre par rapport à son ami de l'époque Truffaut, avec qui il a eu ensuite des mots. Le Mépris est un film que j'ai revu de très nombreuses fois et qui, peut-être contrairement à d'autres films de Godard, a acquis une sorte de classicisme qui fait qu'on peut le revoir indéfiniment, j'ai l'impression, puisque les films classiques sont ceux qu'on peut revoir constamment, qui ne sont pas des... Enfin, je ne sais plus qui disait que les classiques ne sont pas, en ce qui concerne les livres, ne sont pas des livres qu'on lit, mais des livres qu'on relit. Et pour les films classiques, je pense que c'est aussi des films qu'on revoit, et c'est le cas, je crois, pour un film comme Le Mépris. Alors, en revanche, il se trouve que mon fils, qui a 18 ans aujourd'hui, mais qui a vu À bout de souffle quand il avait 11 ans, a été saisi par ce film aussi, et il est devenu extrêmement cinéphile. Alors, comme il avait beaucoup aimé À bout de souffle, il a été vraiment très très marqué, et donc comme moi je l'avais été, finalement beaucoup plus tôt, mais il l'avait vu en DVD, j'ai décidé de lui montrer Pierrot le Fou. Une ou deux années plus tard, et ça l'a terriblement ennuyé, et du coup moi aussi mais je ne sais pas, c'est peut-être la contagion. Je pense que si je le revoyais maintenant, ce serait peut-être un petit peu différent.
And you, Jim, there is one particular film of Jean-Luc of this period, this first period, you know, the period that it's what you care. Whereas the fiction is still something that is so inventive, but at the same time, so what you can say to Jean-Luc, you can never say that, but normal, can you tell me if there is one or two particular films that still stays with you, or?
Wow, you know, they all do. Just the films that Pascal mentioned some of them illustrate such a kind of diversity in playfulness of the form of cinema. When I saw A Bout de Souffle, I thought, you mean all of these jump cuts? You can really do that? You can make a story like that? It was fantastic, opening up so many things. The atmosphere of Alphaville still I find incredibly haunting, and his interest in série noire and crime fiction and using Eddie Constantine in a science fiction setting, this kind of something very stunning to me, still in my memory. A film like Le Mépris is almost like he is making an homage to Vincent Minnelli. He is doing something very grand and something with all kinds of references inside to Fritz Lang and, I don't know, something incredible as well. Masculine Feminine is one of my very favorite films, partly because of the presence of Jean-Pierre and the form of this film as well. And, you know, Weekend, another remarkable divergence from these. I don't know where to begin. You know, these things just continue to reverberate for me. I did recently watch Pierrot le Fou again, and I remember it being striking and the ending being very shocking, but this time I found the ending hilarious, and I don't know why the difference in response, you know? But yeah, I don't know. They're all quite remarkable, and this is only several of the many incredible films that he's made.
Well, Jim, one film that you've left off the list, which I think it seems to me is very important for your work in a way, which is Bande à part. Band of Outsiders, because yes. You think of the two guys and the girl in that film, and in Stranger Than Paradise.
Yes, I think I unconsciously was referring to Band Apart. I wasn't consciously,
yeah.
But I certainly see its inspiration definitely in there. So I would never deny it, even though it wasn't a conscious thing.
Je crois que d'ailleurs Jim comme Godard sont dans une enfin il y a un héritage très particulier enfin, qui sous une forme moderniste de ce qu'on a appelé le film noir américain et moi c'est ça qui m'a accroché aussi dans les premiers films de Godard. Je crois qu'il y a ça dans Bande à part, il y a ça dans À bout de souffle, il y a ça dans Le Petit Soldat, dans ces films de Godard, comme dans Strangers in Paradise et aussi celui avec Roberto Benigni, Down by Law, il y a comme un souvenir du thriller, du film noir américain, qui a été pour moi quelque chose de très très important aussi. Je pense qu'il y a une relance moderniste particulière, mais qui prolonge aussi ce qu'a apporté le film noir américain, je crois.
Yes, and the references to, and you know, even having Sam Fuller and Melville make statements within his film, his films is a direct, you know, acknowledgement of this. Certainly, À bout de souffle refers very much to série noire, and he's got the gun in the car and the cops, he's going to kill a cop and all these things.
Well, I think for me, the revelation of Godard's first period, if we call it that, for À bout de souffle to Weekend, is that he was of all the new wave directors, he was the one who was most making films as a critic. I think, even though I think there are ways in which you could argue that even Alain René, who never wrote, was a critic. And for me, the way I define that is, actually, interestingly enough, it was instinctive. It was not deliberate, because I learned this from Godard himself, which is very interesting when you said that, you know, that the effect of Band à part was unconscious. Because I wrote, for example, about when Godard's Collected Criticism came out, that for me, the best criticism, in a way, of German Expressionist cinema was Alphaville, that it was a comment on all the films of German Expressionism. And Godard said, basically, in effect, I mean, I can't quote but paraphrase, is that that was correct, but I didn't know it at the time I was doing it. So that even though, in other words, he was operating as a critic, like every other, I think, important filmmaker, he was working instinctively. And so it was only later, years later, that he realized that's what he was doing. And in Histoire de Cinema, he acknowledges it by showing you clips from Alphaville and clips from Fritz Lang's Destiny, or, you know, La Trois Lumières in French, at the same time, to show you that there was that link there. But it's, to me, amazing that he wasn't conscious of it, because you literally have someone creeping along the walls like Caligari. You have, you know, light changes, which are like those in Faust of Murnau. You have this thing about what is it turns the night into day, poetry, which is also like Murnau. It's like you have the elevator in the hotel from The Last Laugh. It's like you can go down the list of every important German film, of, you know, silent German film that had expressionist elements. And it's there. You know, there's Nosferatu, there's Professor Nosferatu also, and turning into negative at one point, which also happens in Nosferatu. But yet, despite all of this, it was because I think what happens in the first period of Godard is that he was operating instinctively, but his instincts were those of a critic. And he was learning, in a sense, as masterful as he was in a certain way, he was still learning his tools, because I think what we find in the later films, in the later periods, is much more mastery of tools and just relation to how do you build an image, how do you create a soundtrack, and doing much more masterful things in certain ways, whereas he had the freedom of his instincts, it seems to me, in these earlier films, and that's why they cover so much ground. I mean, I felt that was, as one indication of the importance for me of his films in the 60s, Richard Rowd gave a lecture at Museum of Modern Art in New York, and he showed just an excerpt without subtitles from Deux Trois Choses que je sais d'elle. And I was so excited by what I saw. I knew he was showing it again a month later, the full feature. So I was able to actually buy the script of the film. And I got a French dictionary, and I translated word for word, everything that I could get through before the film came back, so that I could see it and try to follow it. Because even though I, had studied French a little bit in college, I was totally inept when it came to mastering the language. I want to say, by the way, that unlike Pascal and Jim, I have not prepared anything. But at the same time, when I teach, I don't prepare either. And the reason why is I believe in dialogue, not monologue. So please, anyone who has a question or a response or a disagreement, please interrupt me at any point. Because the reason why I don't like to prepare is because I feel like I need to know my audience. I don't want to make up something when I don't know who I'm talking to. And for the same reason, in most cases, I've refused to do single audio commentaries, because when I've done audio commentaries, I always like to have someone else that I'm having a dialogue with.
I just wanted to say one thing. I think it's so interesting what you said about being a critic and this kind of freedom or this not consciousness of what he might be taking as inspiration. But I think he had an incredible freedom by not having a sophisticated grasp on how films are supposed to be made. This isn't very articulate, but I think there was a lack of, it's not quite the right word, of sophistication formally that left him to be very free and open, but there is no lack of sophistication in his knowledge and joy of cinema as a form. He obviously had, he had digested so much of cinema and loved it so much that there's a joyousness, and maybe there's a funny a little explosion of these two things that left him totally free formally in these early films, and yet he was drawing on this wealth of joy of what cinema means to him.
Well, what's interesting, because I think what you're saying echoes in a way one thing that Wells said, that he was able to do as much as he did in Citizen Kane because he didn't know you couldn't do that, basically.
Yeah, I think Abu de Soufla shows, well, gee, how can you do that? Just make the film of all these jump cuts. And, I think he just, well, why can't I?
Well, it was apparently, the story was is that the rough cut was 2.5 hours long, and they said it's got to be shorter. And so he said, I don't want to lose whole scenes, so why not do it this way?
And there's no sync sound either.
Right? Yeah. And that's another thing, that the whole use of sound is something he, would discover later. And the use of music, because even the use of music, it's a beautiful score by Marshall Salal, but it's very uncharacteristic because he basically got Marshall Salal because of Melville. Melville had used him on an earlier film, and he wound up being Marshall Salal's greatest score, I think. He did a very interesting score, or finished a score for Deux Hommes en Manhattan prior to that. But that was basically how he got the job, because Godard himself has never shown the same kind of interest in jazz that would lead to, that type of score, I think. But I do think he later was extremely critical of Breathless, because he said he thought it was Scarface and it was actually closer to Alice in Wonderland. And he also thought it was when he became more political or moved to the left, rather, because he was always political, that he considered it a fascist film. I think because of This sort of the way that violence is sort of glamorized in a certain way.
I think he's critical with everything he makes. You know, I don't think it's particular. When he goes to another place, he critiques what he made before. He's not, you know, maybe now he's critical with everything that he made in the 68 and 70s and everything. That is something that when someone is like Godard, he's always critics about what he made before.
Yeah.
That's all. You know, I don't think that you can have to hear what he thinks about his work. I don't think it's interesting what he says about his work. Everything,
yeah.
I think it's... And there is something I'd like to point. I don't know if it's true or not, but you know, Lannenberg started existing against something, okay? Against something, against some rules, against something. That at that moment, the French cinema was French of studios, everything with rules and everything. And someone told me not a long time ago, I don't know if it's true or not, that when you go and you are not in the studios and everything, you didn't have to apply to the rules, to the normal syndical rules that you were before if you were in the industry, in the studios. And that's one of the things that put them working outside of the, and with the, un décor naturel et pas des décors. Donc il y a tout ça ensemble qui a fait que cette révolution est née. Tu vois? Donc c'est simplement quelque chose qui arrive de rien. Parce qu'à bout de souffle, si vous voyez les premiers courts-métrages de Godard, de Truffaut, etc., il y a beaucoup déjà d'à bout de souffle là-dessus, dans cette liberté. C'est pas qu'arrive comme ça chez à bout de souffle, ça arrive à partir d'un mouvement qui existe, de tourner sans scénario écrit, ou avec quelques lignes, à partant des choses, des décors naturels. Donc c'était vraiment une révolution à un moment, à tous les niveaux. Tu vois. Donc,
oui, et d'ailleurs, il faut... je crois que c'est le moment de rappeler aussi, l'apport évidemment capital qu'a été le travail avec Raoul Coutard, qui vient de mourir.
Absolument.
Et qui... évidemment a permis à Jean-Luc d'utiliser cette technique ultra légère, cette technique que Coutard avait peut-être acquise comme cinéaste de guerre, puisqu'il il s'était engagé en Indochine, c'était pas un progressiste non plus, mais en tout cas il avait permis cette extrême rapidité, cette extrême légèreté de et ce côté action qu'il y a dans les premiers films de Godard, qui l'a accompagné longtemps aussi.
Also, just one other side thing of what you were saying about the kind of rigidity of the system at this time. An example is Jean-Pierre Melville applied to the Union after being in the French underground and everything. He wanted to be an assistant director and enter into the system, and because he was rejected, he decided, okay, well, I'll just start my own production company and I'll make films my own way. And he had to circumvent the structure at the time to make his very particular type of, well, crime films for the most part.
Yeah, well, I think there's an interesting group of French filmmakers that this was true of in one way or another. I mean, Bresson belongs to that category, Tati, Franju.
That is different. This is they work with this in the system, then they know how to do it inside the system. If they want it in formal terms, they were completely, you know, so inventive that they escaped to that. But it's not exactly what it was in Nouvelle Vague, you know. Nouvelle Vague was another thing. It was really something, you know, we take the power in some way against all the rules that exist at this moment. It was much more there than it was the other ones that at that moment worked. You know, Tati had a lot of problems to do his films, but he always do in certain kinds of, you know, of an artisan, but taking care because of a studio, mostly of his films and everything. It was different, you know.
Yes. No, it's true. I think I was thinking more almost existentially that they were independent.
Yeah.
But one point I wanted to make about Godard as a critic, which I think is important, is that there's a tendency nowadays to think of a lot of American directors doing the same thing, and I don't think it's usually true. I think when, for example, you have an homage by Martin Scorsese or Coppola or Peter Bogdanovich, these are not critical statements. They're almost sort of like memories of things that they cherish in the films. But to me, my definition of what criticism does is it changes your perception of the film that's being criticized. And I think that's what something that Godard did. To a certain extent, Rivette did it in some of his films. I think Luc Mollet did it. But the others, for me, did not. I don't think you get that from Romare, and I don't think you get it really so much from Truffaut. Perhaps you get it from René, which is interesting, because I think René had such a vast knowledge of cinema, although he isn't often credited with that, that he was the one who introduced André Bazin to German expressionist silent film, for example, who showed it to them for the first time. And I think that that knowledge is in his film. So I think there is a critical appreciation in René's films, but again, a different kind, because he didn't write, and it was instinctive, not as systematic as it might have been with Godard. But I think at a certain point, at the end of Weekend, by the time around that time, Godard sort of ceased being a cinephile, and has not really been a cinephile in the same way ever since. Or if he is a cinephile, he reverts to the cinephile of his earlier period. It's almost like he doesn't challenge his earlier criticism. He accepts it as part of history to a large extent. And I think that's, some people have complained of Histoire de Cinema, that he doesn't challenge his own earlier writing. But I think actually his earlier writing is an achievement that deserves to be historicized in a lot of ways. And for me, the publication of his collection of criticism is as important as the release of any of his features in certain ways. And I think that he has often said, and I think it's true, that there's always been a kind of tug of war in his work between fiction and essay. But he's stronger in a way as a person who writes essays. He doesn't feel he's, and I think correctly, that he's very skillful as a storyteller. And that's one reason why he felt comfortable with Histoire de Cinema, because he knew it was an essay. He didn't have to pretend to be a storyteller in the same kind of way, as he often has to do with many of his features. And I think that there's a kind of, in his later period, a resentment against stories, a resentment against stars, that when he has to have stars, he usually gets even with them some ways through the films, you know, in one way or another. Because I think stars are another way that of a possible interfering with his freedom.
I don't agree at all with that. I think not at all. You know, Jean-Luc takes what we give him, or he takes even what we don't want to give him. But anyway, c'est pas. Tu vois, il est contre personne. Tu vois, il pur et simplement. Si on l'utilise de long, il l'utilise d'une certaine façon. S'il l'utilise de Pardieu, il l'utilise d'une certaine façon. S'il l'utilise Huppert, il l'utilise d'une certaine façon. Mais c'est pas contre eux. C'est ça qui est génial. Ouais. C'est pas contre eux. C'est peut-être un prenant d'eux des choses qu'ils ne savent pas qu'ils ont. Donc c'est ça qui est absolument génial parfois dans ces films-là. Donc ils sont complètement... Ils s'en foutent, ça. Donc les stars, c'est pas... Tu vois, évidemment, si vous voulez, vous pouvez comparer, vous dites le mépris. Le mépris, c'était une commande de Carlo Ponti. Vous voyez un peu ce qu'il a fait avec Brigitte Bardot, etc. Oui. etc. Donc si vous voulez, c'est pas parce qu'il méprise quoi qu'il soit qu'il fait ce film-là. C'est au contraire, il dit ok, j'ai ce matériel, comment on va travailler ce matériel? Et Jean-Luc, c'est comme ça. Et la politique, c'est la même chose. Comment je travaille ce matériel? Comment je fais maintenant? Qu'est-ce que je fais maintenant? Et c'est ça qu'il se pose toujours les questions. Et c'est là-dessus où il devient intéressant. Parfois un peu rébarbatif dans un certain film, d'autres moins, mais c'est ça que c'est incroyable. Quand vous revoyez les films de Jean-Luc maintenant, j'ai revu Tout va bien l'autre jour, c'est quand même, c'est un des films les plus impressionnants que j'ai vu. À l'époque, j'étais complètement à côté. À l'époque, les gens disaient, ok, il a profité d'Yves Montand et Jane Fonda, et on va... C'est pas du tout ça.
Tu vois, il a pris deux, il a fait presque, tu vois, qu'il se voit dans un miroir. C'est ça qui est étonnant.
No, but
c'est ça
I should film, clarify that what I meant or to say or should have said was that he wasn't opposed to individual stars. He had a certain gripes with the star system, with the institution of financing films by stars. That's what I really felt was what I intended to say.
Jean-Luc, he's take the money and run. That's all. Donc, il ne faut pas non plus se créer des histoires. Take the money and run, and I do what I do in my freedom. That's all. Nobody, jamais quelqu'un a empêché que lui fasse ce qu'il faut. Il faut voir qu'il a fait des commandes. Vous aurez pu voir ici. Grandeur et décadence, une petite truc, une petite truc de commerce. Si vous voyez ici, ça a été. Il a fait ça pour TF1. Okay. On essaie d'avoir maintenant le matériel. TF1 ne sait même pas que ça existe. Tu vois, France Tour des Tours, ça a été fait pour France 2. Des choses comme ça. Donc, tu vois, il prend où il peut, il le fait, avec sa liberté. Il n'a pas de conscience de dire je dois détruire. Lui-même, si tu veux, c'est dans cette liberté qui est assez incroyable ce qu'il fait. Et c'est là-dessus que je trouve que son parcours est quelquefois exemplaire là-dessus, pour nous tous, tu vois. C'est quelqu'un qui est comme ça. Même s'il y a des films, après, si on voit maintenant, oh là là, ok, si tu veux, là... Mais, quand même, il y a quelque chose dans cette liberté qu'il sent, si tu veux, il n'est pas là, tu vois, après, dans son discours, il peut évidemment régner ça, etc., mais dans la façon de faire, c'est quelqu'un que même maintenant, qui le produit maintenant ? Wild Bunch. Il ne faut pas oublier ça. Il prend l'argent chez White Bunch, il fait ce qu'il veut. C'est comme ça. Et donc Jean-Luc, tout son travail était comme ça. Toujours. Toujours. Et ça n'a pas changé. C'était Beauregard au départ, après c'est ça. C'est pour ça que son rapport au producteur, c'est assez intéressant. C'est ça que personne n'a jamais parlé. Parce que lui-même, c'est un producteur. Donc c'est quelque chose que les gens n'en parlent pas, c'est son rapport au producteur. Comme il est passé des gens incroyables comme Beauregard et Brandberger, si tu veux, à des gens comme Jean-Pierre Rassam, à des gens comme Alain Sard, tu vois, qui produisait tous les gros films. Tu vois, attends, Alain Sard, c'est un producteur de ce qu'il y a de plus commercial en France. Et c'est avec Jean-Luc qu'il avait le meilleur rapport. Tu vois, donc c'est ça que c'est intéressant de voir comment ce qui est Jean-Luc. Il ne faut pas le classer. Tu vois, donc c'est
une autre... C'était un rapport de voyous, c'est parce qu'ils étaient tous les deux un petit peu voyous.
C'est un peu ça. Mais c'est un génie après.
Mais non, oui, parce que ça, le côté voyou de Godard était quelque chose d'intéressant quand même, y compris comme critique. Ça n'a jamais été un critique analytique comme avait pu l'être Bazin ou Romer, c'est-à-dire ou Douchet, même enfin des critiques pour parler de gens qui étaient dans la même revue. Qui étaient des critiques qui essayaient de raisonner leur goût et leur désir. C'est un critique qui procédait par intuition. C'était déjà un artiste comme critique. Il procédait par affirmation provocante sans tellement de justification. Je me souviens d'une phrase, par exemple... qui est « J'admire Nuit Blanche » de Visconti, mais « J'aime Sommerlegg » de Bergman. Ça n'est pas, c'est une affirmation. Et ça veut dire c'est l'affirmation d'un goût. Et c'est comme ça. Et dans ces films, il y a cette même, ce côté intuitif, provocant, qui procède par formule coupante, comme ça, bon, et qui, par la suite, quand il a plus tard abandonné la narration, ça donne ces films quand même très très bizarres que sont les derniers, qui sont parfois un petit peu indigestes parce que c'est des films qui se veulent beaucoup plus spéculatifs, alors qu'ils gardent ce côté ce côté constamment déroutant en fait et intuitif.
I had two thoughts. When you were saying that he takes the money and runs, you know, I remember reading a thing about he was financing the film Sauve qui peut la vie, and we have this thing called product placement, where you ask certain companies, will you give us some money or some airplane tickets or whatever if we use your product in the film. And Godard said to his producer, okay, what's the maximum amount of money I can get from these products. And they said, well, how many products do you want to put in the film? He said, as many as possible. So throughout the film, everything, you see a car go by, it says Cinzano. You see Evian on the umbrellas. He put it, everything.
It's the same policy as Jerry Lewis, actually.
We call it pee-pee, product placement. Yeah. But the other thing I found very interesting when Jonathan was talking about this blurring of essays and storytelling, I find in the sort of next period of Godard, films like La Chinoise, or what's the one with Jane Fonda?
Tout va bien.
Tout va bien. He's very much blurring these things together in a very fascinating way, I find. That was an interesting, you know, procedure of his.
Yes, although I think after 68, it actually, the films become really essays and not fictions for a long time. Even in Tout va bien, it's a very cursory fiction. You don't remember the fiction. You remember, they're used as props, but basically. And then he goes back, with Sauve qui peut la veuve, he tried to go back to fiction in a certain way. In fact, I think he said, I'm like an airplane landing on the earth of story, he said.
Well, is Jacques Dutronc? Is it Jacques Dutronc?
No, yeah. Jacques,
and he's playing Monsieur Godard.
Yeah.
That is another,
But he also said, one of the things that I thought that was most fascinating when I interviewed him the first time was on the, about Sauve qui peut la vie. He said, I want to be considered an airplane, not an airport, which means that people should take me to where they want to go and get off. And that he doesn't want to be the destination. He wants to be the vehicle, and which to me describes perfectly the way I like to function as a critic, actually. That, you know, I don't feel the critic should have the first word or the last word. They should be part of the conversation. And maybe improve the quality of the conversation. But in the same kind of way, Godard was not trying to, he was basically saying, I'm providing people with vehicles who take it where they want to go. And I think that that's an acknowledgement that he respects the freedom of the viewers at the same time as respecting his own freedom.
Well, I just want to be more radical than you. I don't think he ever he was ever a storytelling. He was either essay or a poet. And
yes.
The poems are when he was in love. There are really poems to the you know, Anna Karina and all this, you know. And the rest are, you know, vivre sa vie, there is no storytelling, you know. Infâme et infâme, there is no storytelling, maybe two quotes. All this, I don't think he ever was interested in storytelling. You know, he's so, the writer and more a poet than anything in some phases, and after essays, and after, I don't know, like he says a little bit, rebarbatif at the end, like we agreed with some incredible things in his last movies. That's what I think, and that's what.
Well,
I
he's
think.
Also said to me in an interview, which actually quite moved me that he would say this, is that he, and this was in 1980, he said, I think I'm not a very good screenwriter, but that I can be a good director. Which is another way of saying the same thing, I think.
Any question?
In terms of what Paulo just said, that was not any storytelling. How, Pascal, do you think was the process of, for example, Infâme et Infâme or Vivre sa vie, in terms of writing the film in this kind of poetry language or improvisation? Because I saw some notes in the book edited at the Pompidou, and it was quite amazing for me to see that he has also planned the kind of storyboard drawing by himself and notes and it's already is nowadays for me it's a big question on how he was managed to create this storytelling by his own language. Of course, I don't know if you have more information about that.
Yeah, I have not.
Non, j'ai, Une femme est une femme, c'est son troisième film, cette film. Et c'est le premier aussi de ces films, j'ai l'impression, où il commence à lâcher le récit, où il y a moins de récits, où il y a quelques lignes de scénario, et le film, on a l'impression, se construit presque au jour le jour. Parce que dans À bout de souffle, il y a un scénario, après tout, et dans Le Petit Soldat aussi. Le Petit Soldat, finalement, c'est Une femme est une femme, et le deuxième film qui soit sorti de lui, premier film en couleur, il y a une expérimentation avec la couleur, il y a une expérimentation avec le temps des séquences. Par exemple, il y a toute une séquence où Belmondo et Anna Karina sont assis dans un café et ils écoutent de bout en bout une chanson d'Aznavour qui passe de bout en bout. C'est une chose qui n'avait jamais été faite et qui est une mise à l'épreuve du spectateur d'une certaine façon, parce qu'on n'est pas habitué. En général, on coupe dans la chanson, on passe à autre chose, on essaye que le récit se avance. Et lui, au contraire, non, il fait stagner à ce moment-là le récit pour qu'on reste simplement sur la chanson. C'était des choses extrêmement nouvelles et extrêmement, beaucoup plus déroutantes encore. Mais on voit bien que c'est en même temps le moment où la narration, il essaye de commencer à lâcher la narration. Et ce qu'il a essayé finalement de plus en plus de faire, au point de finalement détruire complètement la référence à tout scénario pour aller dans des expériences de plus en plus radicales. Alors que tout de même, dans ces deux premiers films, il y a un récit relativement construit, même s'il prend de grandes libertés. On a un rythme de récit qui commence à... Ensuite, il y a eu des retours en arrière quand il a fait évidemment Le Mépris. Dans Le Mépris aussi, il y a d'extrêmes libertés qui sont prises avec la narration classique. Et voilà. Enfin, je ne sais plus que je sais pas exactement si j'ai répondu à votre question.
I don't know, Tim, if if you know any kind of relationship between Cassavetes and Godard in terms of the cinematography, and if because also there is a kind of freedom that was very important later, but this is something that I can see a kind of bridge between them somehow. I don't know if you.
One thing that certainly, I don't know if this is to what extent this addresses your question, but he took over the kind of like techniques of cinema verite, and in a certain kind of way, what Cotard brought to his cinema was bringing almost like a kind of a documentary approach towards fiction. And one thing he often said, I mean, the theoretical aspect is so important with him, is that whether you start with documentary or fiction, you wind up with the other. The opposite, always. When of course is absolutely true, because you look at Flaherty and, you know, Nanook of the North is a fiction film. And you even have this lecture in La Chinoise when they says that, you know, if you look at the Impressionists, that they're really, in other words, you look at the paintings by Cézanne and that they're Cézanne is like Lumiere, and Méliès was actually making newsreels because he was filming famous events, so there were current events and so on. So the whole idea of what's documentary and what's fiction, it seems to me throughout the history of cinema, one recipe I have for cutting edge cinema is cinema in which documentary and fiction become confused. I actually think Jim Patterson is a beautiful example of that, in certain ways, because it's a film about everyday life that's constructed, and in that sense, it has a sense of being, you know, a documentary of being about real things, but at the same time being a fiction. And I think that Godard seems to me the first one who really perceived this kind of contradiction throughout the history of cinema that I think is very basic. You know, proposing a different way of thinking about it, which I think is quite radical, really, because it's denying the presuppositions that most people have about what fiction is and what documentary is. I mean, Rivette had a similar idea when he said that, you know, if you look at Intolerance, Intolerance is more about the year that it was made than it is about any of the historical periods in which it's set. Which is, in a way, another way of saying the same thing, I think, to some extent.
Il y a un point dont on n'a absolument pas parlé et dont je pense qu'il faut, faut quand même le mentionner au sujet de l'œuvre de Godard et qui est d'ailleurs un point qui rapproche aussi Jim de Godard. C'est tout à fait essentiel, c'est quand même c'est le comique. Il y a un usage du comique, il y a un usage du rire dans les films de Godard. Qui est d'emblée, qu'on trouve d'emblée dans À bout de souffle, même si c'est une histoire tragique, si on veut. On a, par exemple, cette chose qui arrive à un moment comme ça, où Belmondo est en voiture, je crois, et se tourne vers la caméra et dit cette phrase qui reste mémorable. « Si vous n'aimez pas la mer, si vous n'aimez pas la montagne, si vous n'aimez pas la campagne... »
Country.
Allez vous faire foutre. C'est quelque chose d'absolument constant dans les films de Godard, à la fois ce côté provoquant, cette apostrophe directe au spectateur, et c'est drôle. Enfin, je veux dire, il y a un truc de comique, un truc de drôlerie. Qu'on trouve aussi un petit peu dans les films de Jim souvent avec Benigni, avec des gens comme ça.
But I haven't thought this through, but just a reaction. Interesting to bring up Cassavetes and Godard because I believe A Bout de Souffle and Shadows are being made at the same time, with
roughly
with handheld kind of approach, which is usually at that point attributed more to a documentary style. The difference, I thought it was interesting what Paolo said about those early films of Godard being love stories in their way, or he was in love, which is certainly a big element of those stories. But there's a very, and all of John Cassavetes' films to me are about love. All of them are love stories, and it's the complexities of love. And yet, their approaches are almost opposite in that Cassavetes is a very raw, emotional approach. It seems vérité. It seems like it's really happening. And Godard has a very, there's a distancing. Yeah, that's very opposite of Cassavetes.
Rest is very important for him.
Yeah, I get that. That makes sense. You know, a Brechtian kind of distance from things, representational, whereas Cassavetes wants none of that between you and the film.
Actually, having seen Detective again last night, Cassavetes is one of the three people that Detective is dedicated to.
Really?
Along with Clint Eastwood and Edgar Ulmer, actually.
Can we, in a certain way, say that it was, as you told, that was the freedom that took Godard, making is so diverse in the filmography and so much genres that he made, like poetry, like essays, like adventures films, like can we compare in somehow his filmography or the diversity to Kubrick's or to Tarkovsky's, like so diverse, and it's all about freedom?
Well, I think what's complicated in Godard's case is that, and it changes a lot in the course of his career, but it seems to me one of the things I valued most about his films is I regarded them as newspapers. I would go to see Godard films to find out what was happening in the world. And the only other filmmaker I know who, to me, who had that capacity, and it wasn't by wanting to be have it, but it was just something that they had, is Kiarostami had that for a certain period, I think. I think up until the Wind Will Carry Us, at least, is that his films were about what was happening in the world. And the difference, of course, is that Godard's films were all oriented towards cities and Western civilization, whereas Kiarostami's films were almost all taking place in the sticks. But this was an interesting way, and the world was changing, because the big companies were doing the same thing everywhere. And so it made more parts of the world have, you know, being in the same condition at the same time. But I think the fact that Godard had that is what cut him off from, I mean, made him quite different, I think, from somebody like Kubrick and Tarkovsky. Because what his idea of the world, it seems to me, has changed quite a bit. And it's now much more, today is much more oriented towards the past, actually, in a lot of ways. And towards history and the history of art, you know, and things like that. But there's, at least with Tarkovsky, is of course a spiritual world, very much. And that puts it in a different category, although I guess some people have argued that Godard...
I only compare in the diversity of films, yeah. Not in the genres that they made. Only using the freedom to produce or to direct or to make what they wanted to make.
Yes.
Only these. Obviously, there are no comparison between the filmographies of the three, I think.
Well, only no. That's certainly the case. But it also, it seems to me that there's a big difference in that Kubrick having to be, you know, sort of like making films for a big major studio and having to address all of that at the same time that he had very private concerns that he wanted to, you know, like address, makes it very different, it seems to me, from Godard and Tarkovsky. But it's interesting because I think that, you know, sometimes filmmakers wind up doing the same thing if they even if they start through an opposite ideology, because whatever degree to which they're artists is being an artist means the power to transform whatever materials you're working with and to make something else out of it. So I think it's interesting that Godard said very early in his career that he said, I think if a great film becomes a commercial success, this is based on a misunderstanding. And I think that in a certain kind of way, he felt that the commercial success of films like Breathless were based on misunderstandings. It's like if they really understood what I was doing, they would have stayed away.
It's like when if I see a film gets a good review in Variety, I think it's a kiss of death for that film. It was a great quote by Seijin Suzuki, the Japanese director, was celebrated in South Korea some years ago, and the audience was very reverent toward his films, and they said, you have made these great artistic films, you're a master of cinema. And his response was, I am afraid you have greatly misunderstood. I made these films for money. It's kind of the reverse.
Anyway, most of successes are based on misunderstanding, I think.
Yeah.
Boundary breaker and freedom maker in his art, and yet he's so referential as a young novice new filmmaker. I'm wondering how we bear the weight of Godard and find the freedom within it, so to be without being reverential or referential, because it can be very inhibiting, and he was so free. And even, Jim, your film last night, the simplicity of it is so inspiring. And just this thing of, you know, the history and weight of great art being something which we need to know in order to carry on, but we need to somehow forget in order to be free and carry on inventing. And how do we do that?
Well, but I think part of the trouble is that what you're saying that you want to do is not what Godard set out to do. Because I think the problem is some of the best, greatest filmmakers are people who have no interest in cinema, but who basically find cinema the only way they can express what they want to express. And it seems to me that that's a much better approach than to try to emulate and, or, you know, do what or approximate what another filmmaker does. That really the importance is what life experience and goes into, you know, a work. And I think that Godard was, I think when he made his first film, he was 30 by then. I mean, you know, it wasn't like just starting out. He'd bummed around a large part of the world. He'd, you know, had a lot of false starts of various things. You know, he dropped out of school. He was, you know, he was studying anthropology. He didn't keep up with that. It seems to me, and it's important to think of people like Tati and Bresson had whole complicated lives before they got around to filmmaking. And it's that, those lives that they had before they became filmmakers that counts in something like that.
Because yeah, Nick Ray was in his 40s, I think.
Yeah, right. So, and it's also true of Fuller, for example, too, who had two whole careers as a soldier and as a newspaperman before
he'd lived five lives by the time he made it.
So, I mean, it's sometimes argued that, you know, that the bane of filmmaking can be film schools in a certain way. Because in a way, I may have been had the advantage of never having gone to film school. If I could have majored in film when I was in college, I might have. But I don't think it would have done me any good. I mean, my school was, which was Jim's school, was the Cinémathèque in Paris. And that's, you know, Langlois is a better teacher than you're likely to get in, you know, like in places that you, you know, in most film schools. So I think that having to teach yourself for what you need is more important than sort of being given recipes for how you make it in the industry, which is often which poisons, I think, what a lot of film schools do. You know, because they think in purely commercial, economic terms. I mean, the one film course I ever went to when I was a freshman at NYU, which I went in order to see films, it was Martin Scorsese's mentor, and all he talked about was like story values. I remember the term story values. And that was already an immediate turnoff.
Whatever that is. But as a filmmaker, the way I take that weight off that you're concerned with is that, first of all, I'm a dilettante. So if I read a book that I love, if I see a piece of architecture that I love, if I hear some conversation that's interesting to me, it's then part of me. It's mine. If I see a film I love, I see a film by Max Ophüls, it's mine. It's inside me now. And originality is overrated, if not non-existent. I don't believe really there are original stories or ideas even there. But as many people as there are who would like to make a film, there are that many ways to make a film. And there are that many different films that can be made. So, you know, I think embracing the things that become yours. If I hear some African music, you know, that I love, I'm not African, but yes, I am African because I have that in me. And so I say, gather them and, you know, make them yourself. You have no choice. They're already, you've made them yourself because you responded to them. But I say, don't worry about the weight of reference, of being original. Nothing's really original. And Godard himself at one point said, maybe facetiously, you know, I just make the same film over and over again. Well, you know, of course he doesn't, but in a way he does, you know, yeah. Because maybe he thinks he's just making one long film, in his lifetime. But I say, don't worry about that weight, because those things are positive, not negative. And if you even quote, I've quoted other films blatantly in some of my films, and I don't hide it. I'm not trying to steal it. Well, maybe I am trying to steal it, but I'm saying, look, I'm a thief, you know? I'm proud to be a thief, because that scene from Branded to Kill from Seijin Suzuki's Now, it's mine. I can use it. So I'm not sure everyone would agree. I also love a quote Godard said once, in America, you call it plagiarism. In Europe, we call it homage. So
Faulkner also said, the amateur artist borrows, the professional artist steals.
What I find so amazing also in his first films is the musicality. I mean, the use of the soundtrack that later in his other films is quite seducing to listen only the soundtrack of his films. I don't know if you have any special opinion about that, about the use of the sound and musicality in his early films or not.
Yeah, I don't have an analysis of it. I know I love how he uses sound and music, or, you know, he will blatantly show you that he's not using the sound in sync at times. In some of his later films, he will do very interesting things where, say, he'll use a piece of a quartet by Schubert, and then when he cuts to a new scene, he chops the music off. He doesn't fade it, he chops it off in a mid, you know, figure. He's always trying experimenting with the effect of these things.
I mean, an interesting thing he said about the sound in his first stereo film was Detective, and it only has two channels because he said, I only have two hands. But then he obviously went into four channels after that, implying that he had four hands, but in other films like King Lear.
I think sometimes he smoked two cigarettes at once because he had two lungs, you know. Why not? I'm just making that up.
Okay.
Of the 3D?
That he's using. Do you think that one more time is only... is trying to do something with the new technology or something else?
You're talking about Adieu à Langage? No, I'm sorry, I didn't quite hear.
Because the last film that he made...
Adieu à Langage. I actually find it very exciting, and I think it's... earlier this year, I was privileged to see his actual test reel of 3D, of various other things that he was trying, you know, experimenting with and thinking of using. And it was a question of, you know, what was technologically available and other things. But he, I've heard that there's a possibility his next film may also be in 3D. But I'm sure it changes day by day. So I know he shot part of it in Tunisia, which is kind of intriguing. But I don't know. I think it's who would have guessed that he would have been the director of the New Wave who hung on the longest? I wouldn't, you know, for somebody who smokes that much, it's kind of like defies belief.
Yeah, he's the Keith Richards of cinema.
Well, I think we've probably, maybe should we call it a day?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.